السلام عليكم. Lecture of today is concerned with the posterior triangle as a continuation of the previous two lectures regarding the fascia, the plan of the neck, and then the anterior triangle. And now we'll have some consideration about the posterior triangle. We will go through these topics, the boundaries of the triangle, the roof, the floor of the triangle, the contents, and even subdivisions of the triangle into two main parts. Now, the boundaries of the triangle, as you see here, between the sternal cleidomastoid muscle and the trapezius muscle, and below we have the clavicle, the middle portion of the clavicle. So, the exactly it is between the posterior border of the sternomastoid and the anterior border of the trapezius muscle and the middle portion of the clavicle below. The above, the apex of the triangle lies high up at the back of the skull when the two borders of the muscles will meet here. And here we have what is called the occipital artery passing there. Okay. The roof and the floor of the triangle composed of the following. Now, the roof of the triangle, you know, the triangle is a three-dimensional spatial space or region. And has, of course, roof and floor. The roof is composed of the deep fascia of the neck in this part. This is the sternocleidomastoid, the posterior border, which is the boundary of the triangle, and the anterior boundary of the trapezius. And in between them, this space called the posterior triangle. The roof of it, or roofed by, a part of the investing layer of deep cervical fascia, while the floor of the triangle by the red line here, which is the prevertebral fascia that invests the prevertebral muscles here. Okay, so the triangle has a roof and the floor as shown in the figure here. Now, deep to the prevertebral fascia, we have a group of muscles, which in turns might be considered the floor of the triangle itself. Yani, the triangle, ممكن نقوله انه this is the muscles group that forming the floor of the triangle and covered by the prevertebral fascia. These muscles, from below up upward, we have the scalenus anterior muscle that arises from the cervical transverse processes and passing down to the scalene tubercle of the first rib. Second muscle above it and just lateral and posterior is the scalenus medius muscle, and then the levator scapular muscle, which elevated the scapula in its action, and the splenius capitis muscle, more superior and forming the upper part of the triangle, and in somewhat we have part of the semispinalis capitis muscle seen here at the top of the triangle, at the apex of the triangle. So it's considered as a part of the muscular floor of the posterior triangle of the neck. Now we will have some informations about these muscles in a little explanation. Like the splenius capitis muscle, which is the green one here in this picture, this muscle arised from or attached to the ligamentum Newki. The ligamentum Newki is a fibrous tissue attached to the spines, tips of the spines of the cervical vertebrae. So collectively of these of supraspinous ligaments between two adjacent spinous processes of the cervical vertebrae, along the series of the cervical vertebrae, we will have a single structure, fused single structure called the ligamentum Newki, which is attached to the skin overlying it, and this is responsible for the furrow appearance, depression appearance at the back of the neck. Hasa and the Rialin, we can see a furrow depression on the back of the neck due to the attachment of this ligamentum Newki to the skin overlying it and tether the skin, attach the skin, or firm the skin to it. Now, the other attachment of the muscle to the mastoid process and the lateral third of the supernuchal line here on the back of the skull and its action is the extension of the head and the neck. Extend the head and the neck. Now, the semispinalis capitis, which is seen here in the upper part of the triangle, runs vertically, while other muscles in the floor runs almost obliquely. So, see, the semispinalis capitis muscle, semispinalis, runs more in vertical direction. Runs in vertical direction. Now, we will shift to the contents of the posterior triangle, and we can say that at the apex of the triangle, when the two borders of the muscles meet together here, we can see what is called the occipital artery, which is an important branch of the external carotid artery from the posterior border of it, and supplying the occipital area. And also, we might have at this region the great occipital nerve that emerge and pass up to the scalp, the posterior aspect or the occipital part of the scalp. So this is the one of the contents, nerve and artery at the apex of the triangle. Now, other contents of the posterior triangle at the lower part of it, we have also two important arteries. These are the suprascapular and the transverse cervical, which is lower, the suprascapular artery, lower than the transverse cervical. This is the transverse cervical in a higher position, and this is the suprascapular. Both of them are branches of what is called the thoracervical trunk, which is a part of the subclavian artery. Thoracervical trunk, which is a part of the first part of the, which is a branch of the first part of the subclavian artery. These two important structures are present in the lower part of the triangle, and we can see it here. And I think they are so risky if the person have injury, for example, a fracture of the clavicle here, we might be injured here, or even a stab wound in the posterior triangle at this point. Other contents of the triangle, also we have nerve and lymph nodes. The lymph nodes are the following. We have a numerous and small many lymph nodes above the clavicle, just above the clavicle. We call them the supraclavicular lymph nodes. And these are important lymph nodes because they might be inflamed and enlarged in many, many diseases, even simple infection or dangerous or malignancy of the thoracic or pleural or even the lung. Now, the other lymph nodes seen in the posterior triangle, we have what is called the occipital nodes. They are two or three in numbers, and these lymph nodes, as seen here in the diagram or the figure, sorry, here, the picture, they are inflamed characteristically in what is called the German measles or the rubella. The rubella, mainly in children's, and this is one of the features and the clinical signs can be examined here. We have tender and enlarged lymph node, occipital lymph nodes, one of the features of the German measles or rubella in children's. Okay, now the accessory nerve, which is one of the cranial nerves, actual fact, it is the 11th cranial nerves, passing in its course through the posterior triangle. It passes from the posterior posterior border of the sternomastoid, in junction between the upper and middle third of the border of the muscle, and then runs inside the triangle under the cover of the fascia, and then reaching disappeared behind or beneath the trapezius muscle in a junction between the middle and the lower third of the anterior border of the trapezius muscle. Simply, this nerve is the 11th cranial nerves, is a motor to the muscles, the sternomastoid and the trapezius, And actually, it arises from two roots, cranial root of the accessory nerve and the spinal root of the accessory nerve from the upper cervical spinal segment. So the nerve passes vertically downward on the levator scapulae muscle in the floor of the triangle, and as we said, this appeared underneath the trapezius muscle. As we said, it is a motor. It is motor supplied to the sternomastoid and the trapezius muscle. Obviously, if we have injury of the accessory nerve, this will lead to paralysis of the ipsilateral side of the trapezius and the sternomastoid. And we can examine the integrity of the nerve by asking the patient to shrug his shoulder or her shoulders. وبالتالي the normal on the right side we can shrug, elevate the shoulder, while on the left side as seen here in the picture it is paralyzed nerve, وبالتالي the patient cannot elevate or shrug the shoulders. This is one of the examination done in the clinics to examine the integrity of the accessory nerve. Also we can see here the other contents of the posterior triangle deep between the two muscles, the scalenus anterior and the scalenus medial. Between two these muscles we have this is the yellow structures, the roots of the brachial plexus. You know we have a brachial plexus in the axilla, and this plexus comes from the roots from the cervical segment number C5, C6, 7, and 8, you know, and even we have additional the thoracic segment number 1, T1. So this root value of the brachial plexus passing in between the scalenus anterior muscle more anterior and the scalenus medial more posterior, as if they are sandwiched between two muscles. Also, this is the contents of the posterior triangle. The phrenic nerve lies over the scalenus anterior muscle, passing downward from the lateral side of the muscle to the medial side of the muscle, and then passing to the pleural cavity and passing to supply the diaphragm. It is the motor supply of the diaphragm, and an actual fact, it is mixed sensory and motor nerve. Like, you know, the main motor function of the phrenic nerve is the motor supply of the diaphragm. Other contents of the posterior triangle, we are continuing with the nerve contents of the triangle, the cervical plexus, in particular the cutaneous branches of the cervical plexus that passing from posterior border of the sternomastoid muscle in the middle, more or less in the middle points of the posterior border, we have emergence of the branches of the cervical plexus and passing just like that, transverse cervical branch. We have also occipital branch, greater occipital nerve, and so on. These are cutaneous branches to the area here of the neck, of the chin, and the lower part here below the mandible, and even the preauricular and postauricular area. Cutaneous innervation of these areas. Okay, now as a conclusion or as a summary for the contents of the posterior triangle, we have vascular contents, the occipital artery in the upper part, the suprascapular artery in the lower part, and the transverse cervical artery in the lower part also. Now the other contents of nerve contents, mainly we have accessory nerve, we have also the cervical plexus, the cutaneous branch of cervical plexus, and also the roots of the brachial plexus, also contents of the posterior triangle, and we have also the lymph node contents of the triangle. Mainly we have supraclavicular lymph node and occipital lymph nodes. Okay. Now we will shift to a small subject, which is the subdivisions of the posterior triangle by the presence of the inferior belly of omohyoid muscle here. هاي العضلة الموجودة. We have ribbon-like muscle pass from the hyoid bone يسموها upper belly of omohyoid. And here we have change of direction from a vertical into more or less oblique or horizontal course, اللي يسموها the posterior belly of omohyoid muscle, أو يسموها the inferior belly of the omohyoid. This muscle will subdivide unevenly and equal two portions. The upper one اللي هو large portion نسميه the occipital triangle, and the lower portion نسميه the supraclavicular triangle. طبعا from the start you know this is a triangle containing many important structures اللي هم supraclavicular with transverse cervical and even the supraclavicular lymph nodes. Here the triangle contains the subclavian artery, more or less the subclavian artery passing deep in the supraclavicular portion or a triangle or subdivisions, and this nerve can be palpable here. We can compress the nerve over the bone will he was the first rib, and we can feel the pulsation of the artery. And sometimes we can use this maneuver to press on the artery firmly to loosen or stop يعني the bleeding. It might occur in the upper limb, in the axilla, or even in the, for example, a wound in the arm. And we can control that by compressing the subclavian artery here. It might loosen or decrease the blood loss. Now, the clinical importance, we can mention it for the posterior triangle as a last slide for the lecture. احنا عندنا many structures صراحة, يعني كل structure عندها clinical importance. يعني for example the accessory nerve اللي هو motor to the trapezius and sternomastoid, تكلمنا على ال injury of the nerve وشنو يصير عندنا paralysis of these muscles. Subclavian artery اللي حكيناها قبل slide also it is an important and risky structure present here. The supraclavicular nodes, they are inflamed in many disease, and even the occipital lymph nodes in the upper part of the triangle might be inflamed in a disease like the rubella or the German measles. So each structure in the triangle might have a clinical importance and relevance. لكنه هذا السلايد نتكلم على فد شيء مهم. احنا بالمحاضرة الأولى أعتقد بالinvesting layer of deep cervical fascia we talk about the external superficial structures موجودة بالنك واللي هي like the external jugular vein, واللي هو one of the important superficial venous drainage from the face and from the neck. This vein is attached to the investing layer of deep cervical fascia. So it is a superficial structure and passing down to the neck to reach the its confluence into the subclavian and sometimes to the confluence of the jugular vein and the subclavian vein. Now, if the nerve is severed or injured by, for example, knife or stab wound in the posterior triangle, now the lumen of the vein will be opened by the attachment of the investing cervical fascia. لأنها attached to it, so the lumen will be opened. There is no collapse of the vein. وبالتالي this will cause two important points. The first one, profuse bleeding. There is no stoppage of the bleeding or even no collapse of the vein, no closure of the lumen of the vein. فبالتالي continuous bleeding راح يكون profuse bleeding. The other important point هو suction of air from outside in. So the air will pass or drawn into the vein وبالتالي cause what is called خاص إذا كان large amount of يعني air. So it is called the clinical and medical emergency air embolism. The air embolism, when we have an air contents inside the circulation, this will reach to the right side of the heart, اللي هو right atrium, وبالتالي the heart will stop to push the blood from the right side to the lung. This might causing severe medical emergency. The patient might pass from this air embolism. So the important points here, when you see in the casualty, as you are a doctor in the future inshallah, you see this patient with a profuse bleeding comes from the lower part of the posterior triangle, directly you should push on the wound and the injury, trying to stop the two points, stop the bleeding and stop the air suction into the lumen. I think this is a very important lecture, and you gain some clinical information and relevance, and I hope you get the benefit and the scope of the lecture. Any questions, I'm ready to answer on the classroom.